and welcome to today's webcast, Driving Referrals with Nursing Home On-Site Hemodialysis. I'm Emily Mongan, staff writer for McKnight's Long-Term Care News, and I'll be your moderator today. Today you'll learn how implementing your own on-site hemodialysis program can help your facility differentiate its services and drive patient referrals, as well as the economic and clinical benefits of an on-site program, operational staffing considerations, and resident success stories. In just a few moments, you'll be hearing from Corey Bennici, administrator at Highland Pointe Health and Rehabilitation Center, about his experience implementing an on-site program. But first, we have a few housekeeping matters to go over. Today's slides will be available for download. To view and print the slides, click on Event Resources beneath the volume control, then click on the PDF of the slide deck. If you think you are having audio problems with this broadcast, please first check the volume control on your machine. We found this is the most common cause of hearing problems on presentations like these. If the problem persists, click on the help button at the upper right of the player. Also, please note there is no call-in number for this webinar. Sound comes right from your computer speakers. There will also be time for an audience Q&A session at the end of today's presentation. If you have any questions for Corey, feel free to type in your question and hit the send button at any time during the webinar, starting right now. Also, at the end of the presentation, we'll have a brief exit survey we ask that you complete. It just takes a few mouse clicks, and we greatly appreciate your feedback on today's webinar. We'd also like to note that this program is made possible by support from NxStage. You can learn more about them and what they can do for you at nxstage.com. Finally, this session will be archived and available on demand shortly after this live broadcast. You can access it again, or others can experience it for the first time, by simply going to the registration page to enter this studio. That address is www.mcknights.com/May16webinar. Now to meet our featured presenter. Today you'll be hearing from Corey Bennici, a licensed nursing home administrator currently working at Highland Pointe, a Sabre Healthcare Group facility in Highland Heights, Ohio. Prior to joining Highland Pointe, Corey worked as administrator of Aurora Manor in Aurora, Ohio. He also got his start working in long-term care at Aurora Manor, working as a life enrichment intern, administrator in training, admissions coordinator, and business office manager. Corey has also served as administrator for Homestead 1 and Homestead 2 in Painesville, Ohio. He holds a Bachelor of Science degree from Kent State University and also serves as a speaker with the Kent State University Long-Term Care Panel of Professionals and is a board member with the Cuyahoga Community College Workforce Community and Economic Development in Healthcare. With that resume, Corey is a great resource to share his experiences with on-site hemodialysis programs and to help you set up your own program for success. So without further ado, Corey, I will hand it over to you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Corey Bennici. I hope you're all enjoying National Nursing Home Week and exploring new ways to celebrate with your residents and staff. I'd like to tell you what an honor it is to be able to speak with you today about my experiences implementing and operating an on-site hemodialysis program. It is a privilege to be able to learn from one another and develop new ways to provide better care for our residents. I'd like to start out by thanking McKnight's, NxStage Medical, Affiliated Dialysis, and my employer, Sabre Healthcare, for allowing me this opportunity to speak with you today. Today I will highlight why Sabre Healthcare chose to start this program at Aurora Manor. I'll provide you some background on Aurora Manor, the challenges that were faced at the facility, and how on-site hemodialysis could help solve these problems. We will discuss the staffing and operational considerations you need to account for, the financial incentives impact, clinical benefits relating to on-site hemodialysis, and why we chose to use the NxStage hemodialysis machines for treatments. By developing a successful on-site hemodialysis program at Aurora Manor, we are seeing the following results. A first-year projected profit in 2017 of $286,000, immediate referral and census growth, significant improvement in coordination of patient care, and clinical and therapeutic benefits to dialysis patients. I'm a huge sports fan, so I like to relate starting our dialysis program to having the number one overall pick in the draft or a free agent signing that everyone knows is going to help the team succeed. On-site hemodialysis is Aurora Manor's draft pick. It's our free agent signing to help our team succeed. I'm not going to say it's our LeBron James, but I will say it's our rookie year, LeBron. You know that you have something special, and you could build with it and around it. Aurora Manor Skilled Nursing and Rehabilitation is a 100-bed facility. It's located approximately 25 miles from Cleveland and Akron. Aurora Manor was built in the early 90s and has always been a well-respected provider of skilled nursing and rehab services in Northeast Ohio. Aurora Manor is a 5-star facility. When you walk into Aurora Manor, it feels warm and welcoming. It has a home-like atmosphere to it. It feels comforting, and there's a ton of longevity amongst the managers and staff. Aurora Manor is a place that's very near and dear to my heart. I got my start at Aurora in 2012 as a college intern in the activities department. This is where I developed a love for the industry and the residents that we care for. Aurora Manor and Sabre Healthcare provided me a foundation that I am grateful for to this day, and for that, they are like family to me. As my career progressed at Aurora as an administrator in training, admissions director, and business office manager, I continued to see the facility succeed at a high level. Traditionally, Aurora Manor operated above 90% occupancy with an average daily skilled mix of 20 to 30 Medicare or managed care residents. I left Aurora Manor for 1 year to take my first job as an administrator with one of our sister facilities. At that time, we were operating at 94% occupancy in 2014. When I had the opportunity to return a year later as the administrator, we were operating at 85% occupancy. During that time frame, two new facilities opened within 5 miles, adding 220 new beds to the area. In 2016, occupancy dropped to 75%. Despite Aurora Manor's stellar reputation, 5-star rating, and significant renovations, we continue to decrease market share of referrals and admissions. The truth was, the majority of Aurora Manor's rooms were semi-private, and these new facilities offered private rooms. As census decreased, our revenue decreased, and the facility was not able to meet budgeted expectations. Aurora Manor could not continue to operate without meeting budgeted expectations and needed to find a new way to succeed. In order for this to happen, we needed to put all of our faith and trust in Sabre Healthcare to provide us with the tools necessary to get the job done. Having corporate support and a company that you believe in is essential to knowing that there's light at the end of the tunnel. Staff and residents saw the decreased census, but knew that we would figure out a way to get through these tough times. We needed to make sure that staff continued to have absolute trust in leadership and complete buy-in to the future of Aurora Manor. Rallying the troops in all staff town hall meetings and team-building exercises to assure our employees knew that Sabre was committed to seeing that we would get back on the right track. Regardless of census or revenue struggles, we made sure to never sacrifice care. Substantial renovations were completed at the facility to renovate the skilled nursing unit, therapy gym, dining room, activities room, and hallway down to the therapy gym. These were wonderful additions to the facility, but Aurora Manor still required a niche program that would separate us from everyone else. This is when it was decided that Aurora Manor would be the first Sabre Healthcare facility to provide on-site hemodialysis to its residents. A partnership was formed with Affiliated Dialysis to provide dialysis treatments in-house. When determining if this would be a program that could succeed, we needed to first see how it could benefit our residents. We looked at the challenges that were faced when having to transport residents to and from outpatient clinics. We encountered consistent issues with increasing transportation costs, customer service and communication issues with transportation providers, inclement weather problems in Northeast Ohio, patients that were too sick for transport and ultimately ended up in the hospital, disruption in care, meals, therapy, and overall breakdowns in coordination of care and treatments. Community dialysis patients and their families also dealt with these recurring problems, and we could now offer a solution for them if they admitted to Aurora Manor. All of these issues could be reduced by providing dialysis treatments in-house at Aurora Manor for our residents. We determined that on a monthly basis, we were paying for 2 to 3 residents to be transported to outpatient dialysis centers. This was an estimated cost of $2,000 or more and an annual cost of $24,000. The glory days for Aurora Manor of being able to pick and choose which referrals we wanted and provided the most profit were gone. We no longer had the luxury of being able to dictate if we would pay for transportation when hospitals sent us dialysis referrals. We were now given an ultimatum telling us to either accept the patient and pay for transport, or the hospital would gladly send to 5 other facilities that would pay for transportation. All of us in this industry have examples of horror stories relating to customer service and communication issues with transportation providers, specifically missed or delayed treatments due to transportation issues, and residents having to wait for hours for a ride back to the facility. Due to issues with transportation companies and changes in wheelchair transport, Aurora Manor began to utilize our bus to provide all wheelchair transports. This cut down on customer service and communication issues, but we still incurred fuel costs, vehicle maintenance, and labor. We had to utilize managers to drive the bus until we were able to hire a driver. This decreased their productivity. Other issues we have encountered are altered meal times, bagged lunches, medication administration problems, and miscommunication with dialysis clinics, all of which throw off the timing and day-to-day routine of residents and staff. These problems also increase the risk of potential citations during annual and complaint surveys. On more than one occasion, I have had issues with residents not being dressed properly for appointments. At one point, we had a resident that did not leave for dialysis without our director of nursing signing off on first. I once received a call from a dialysis center stating that a patient showed up without any shoes on, only to find out that they fell off while transportation company was lifting the resident into the van and the shoes were found in our driveway. Twice I had to send our dietary manager to the dialysis center because we forgot to pack the resident's lunch and needed to send one up. But the most eye-opening occurrence was when a prominent man from our community called me around 6:30 p.m. in tears to say that he left the facility early in the morning and had been waiting for his ride back to the facility since 3 in the afternoon. All he wanted to do was get out of his wheelchair and lay in bed. He felt hopeless and broken. From that day on, we transported this gentleman using our bus, but the writing was on the wall and the damage had been done. In order to appropriately plan for this project, it all came down to research and gathering information. We had to ask ourselves, is this a need in our area? Can we succeed by implementing this program? We looked at who in the area was currently offering on-site hemodialysis and how did they affect our market share. How did we stack up against these other facilities? And will we be looked at by referrals and referral sources as a valuable option for on-site hemodialysis? Ultimately, we felt through our research, reputation in the community, and referral sources that this would work. In the Cleveland-Akron market, on-site hemodialysis is few and far between. Most of these facilities are closer to the greater Cleveland area, and we felt that we were positioned appropriately to capture referrals. When our hospital liaison started asking discharge planners about sending dialysis referrals to Aurora Manor, the response was on more than one occasion, "I have 2 referrals I would send you right now if you had dialysis at Aurora Manor." Once we felt that we could generate census and revenue, we had to think about staffing the program so they would operate efficiently and effectively, the goal always being to never sacrifice care. I know I've said this multiple times, but I really feel this is the most important piece of any project and supported throughout all of Sabre Healthcare. We set goals to measure the success of the program. Our goals were to provide a unique solution to rehabilitation and long-term care dialysis patients not offered in our area, to become a one-stop shop for residents requiring hemodialysis, skilled nursing, rehabilitation, and long-term care services, to increase census and generate revenue, to decrease dialysis transportation issues and expenses, and receive higher therapy scores for dialysis residents receiving therapy. Starting any project requires time, effort, resources, and support to get off the ground. We had the corporate support we needed to move forward, but we knew that this was going to fall on the facility to do the legwork. This meant that it was on our team to see that the program succeeds. I have to admit I felt the pressure and knew there was a lot riding on this, but just like anything else, you have to put the time and effort in to yield the results you desire. We made sure to hold ourselves accountable and always know where we stand. Our regional vice president of operations was tremendous and made sure to support us in any way necessary and keep tabs on the process. More than anything, we tried to make the process fun and exciting to see what the future would hold. I didn't have any experience with dialysis, so this also made me a little nervous. I remember thinking, how am I going to appropriately manage a dialysis unit when I don't know anything about dialysis? I must be crazy. Only I wasn't crazy. I just needed to trust in our partnership with Affiliated Dialysis to lead us every step of the way. Affiliated made it very easy to understand how everything works. We were provided with binders detailing everything we needed to know about their company and the process. Affiliated is based out of Chicago, so we started having weekly conference calls and meetings with their Cleveland team to discuss any and all questions. They had just as much interest in seeing this succeed as we did, so they were attentive to all of our needs. The most important thing for us to do was learn, try to plan for the expected and unexpected, stay organized, and keep a timeline of everything that was going on. We had to keep marketing and staffing in our back pocket at all times because they were essential to launching, sustaining, and succeeding with our on-site home hemodialysis program. We started marketing on-site hemodialysis at Aurora Manor 6 months before starting. Clinical liaisons spread the word at hospitals. Our internal marketing team promoted the program to other skilled nursing facilities, assisted livings, independent livings, outpatient dialysis clinics, physician offices, and community centers in a 30-mile radius of Aurora Manor. This was key since we wanted everyone to know this was coming soon and have details about our program. Our marketer would try to reach up to 5 different places daily to distribute marketing materials like the one in this slide. Since Aurora Manor typically has about 30 admissions per month, we would let all of our skilled residents know about the program so that it would spread back into the community. We admitted 2 residents that were going to receive on-site hemodialysis with us 6 months before we started. We admitted 3 more residents in August of 2016, a month before we started. Upon starting the program, we had 5 residents that were going to be receiving hemodialysis treatments at Aurora Manor. In discussing with Affiliated Dialysis, 4 to 5 residents was a good number to start training with. We could still take dialysis admissions, but we'd have to transfer them out for treatments until we could start treating more residents in-house after the training program was completed. Most of us in the nursing home industry are familiar in one way or another with staffing issues, high turnover, or employee engagement problems. This made appropriately staffing this unit that much more important. The staff that were providing treatments were going to be spending so much time with the residents, it was crucial we got this right from the beginning. There were multiple staffing options for us to consider implementing. I just want to note that regulations on staffing and treatment requirements vary by state and provider, so what we did at Aurora Manor may not work for you in your state. Our options were to train current employees, registered nurses, and state-tested nursing assistants to provide dialysis treatments. We could hire trained dialysis professionals or pay Affiliated Dialysis staff to staff the unit. All options offered pros and cons, but ultimately, we decided to train our current employees to provide dialysis treatments. The biggest reason for this was because we didn't know how fast the program was going to grow. We wanted to make sure we had enough staff members trained to provide daily treatments. If our dialysis census numbers did not warrant a need for them in dialysis, they could still work on the floor as a nurse or nursing assistant. This allowed us to not have to worry about upset staff members that were not getting enough hours and therefore quitting. Again, I just want to mention that regulations on staffing and treatment areas vary by state and provider. One of the biggest driving factors for me on why I wanted to use our own employees to staff the program was because they had a vested interest in it. They were a part of Aurora Manor. They had been through the ups and downs. They heard us talking about it for so long during our all-staff meetings. They wanted to see the building succeed. Our staff deserved the opportunity to help lead us in a new direction and be on the front line when we got started. Not to mention, this was a great career opportunity to learn a new skill set for our RNs and STNAs. We had a sign-up sheet for all staff that were interested in applying and held interviews internally. We selected employees that had longevity with the facility, outstanding attendance record, overall good standing with the facility, quality service and communication skills, show a willingness to learn and dedication to their residents and their job. These employees went through a four-week training program with affiliated dialysis. Once training was complete, we rewarded them with a graduation party to provide their certificates and a $1 per hour wage increase. This was a glorious day for Aurora Manor. We trained a total of 10 employees, 3 RNs, and 7 STNAs that were now trained dialysis technicians. At the end of the presentation, in the appendix, I have more slides on the training process. If you are interested, you can check those out and feel free to ask me any questions. I'll be happy to expand on the training process at that time. It's important to understand how Aurora Manor and affiliated dialysis work together so that it's mutually beneficial for both parties. For Aurora Manor, it's all about census growth based on our payer mix. We now offer a service that generates more referrals and in turn more revenue. We provide a location for dialysis to be performed by our trained staff. We provide dedicated and secure areas for equipment, supplies, and medication. Affiliated dialysis is responsible for equipment and supplies, medication and labs associated with dialysis treatments, dialysis billing and reimbursement. They provide a trainer to complete initial training of Aurora Manor employees. They provide a medical director, RN case manager, licensed social worker, and registered dietitian that frequent the facility on a routine schedule. Aurora Manor and affiliated dialysis are both responsible for making sure that the resident is properly admitted to the facility. When the hospital sends us a referral for a potential candidate of on-site hemodialysis at Aurora Manor, we immediately send that referral to the affiliated admissions team. Affiliated verifies that the referral is a candidate to receive hemodialysis at Aurora Manor. They let us know any other documentation they need from the hospital or dialysis clinic to accept the patient. This may sound taxing, but it actually goes very smoothly after the first couple of tries. The admitting resident requires an attending nephrologist to oversee their dialysis treatment. The nephrologist needs to be credentialed with Aurora Manor and affiliated dialysis, much like an attending physician would. Looking back now, we could have done a better job of getting nephrologists credentialed before we started. This would have saved time and headaches as we progressed further along. If a resident admitted to receive on-site hemodialysis, we made sure to speak with their nephrologist at the dialysis clinic they were previously going to and see if they would like to be credentialed at our facility so they could follow their patient. In September of 2016, Aurora Manor began training our employees to provide dialysis services. We started training on 5 residents that wanted to receive hemodialysis treatments at Aurora Manor. Per protocol, the residents or families had to sign consents with affiliated dialysis to start receiving treatment. These dialysis treatments took place at the patient's bedside. Training concluded toward the end of October, and treatments continued bedside during this time. Upon starting this project, it was determined that Aurora Manor would start providing treatments bedside, but would ultimately construct a 6-chair dialysis suite to provide treatments. Aurora Manor was built with an aquatic therapy room. This room was about 32 feet long by 16 feet wide. Approximately 10 years ago, the pool was removed and the room was turned into a restorative therapy room, but still had the hookups for water to flow in and out of the room. The room also had a closet, bathroom, and office. This was perfect because it had a large enough space for a six-chair dialysis suite, an office for affiliated dialysis staff to lock files and medications, a clean and dirty sink, and a storage room for waste. The only thing we did not have was enough storage space. We utilized other spaces in the facility for storage space for dialysis supplies. Construction began in the middle of October and took nearly 2 months to complete. Capital expenses for this project cost approximately $40,000. This included construction of the room, 7 dialysis-specific chairs, 5 regular and 2 bariatric, and 2 flat-screen televisions mounted on the wall. Line item expenses were minimal. We purchased a pallet jack, rolling stools, and other odds and ends. All in all, these expenses only cost about $500. Once the room was finished and affiliated dialysis completed their necessary checks, we were able to transition from bedside dialysis into the dialysis suite for treatments. This required a few days of training for the staff, but went very smoothly. By the end of December, we had successfully trained all staff members and transitioned all treatments into the dialysis suite. Beginning January 2017, we were officially underway in the dialysis suite and ready to see the program in full swing. We can now see if our efforts would pay off. We celebrated by inviting our referral sources to an open house to show off our newly minted dialysis suite. With a 6-chair dialysis suite, we could potentially treat 18 residents in a 12 to 14 hour day, 5 days per week. We set our projections for January through December for census, revenue, expenses, and net operating income. Our projection for January was an average daily census of 9 dialysis residents, an increase monthly, ending with an average daily census of 18 dialysis in December of 2017. In order to achieve the financial results we desired, we had to look at what payer mix would get us there. We subtracted general operating costs and dialysis labor costs from Medicare A, private insurance, private pay, and Medicaid payers to see what our profit margins would be. Other than general operating expenses, the only expenses that we needed to account for was dialysis labor. We estimated dialysis labor costs of approximately $3,500 per week, $14,000 per month, and $182,000 per year. After subtracting expenses, we projected to be able to make around $160 to $200 per day on a Medicare A, pending the RUG score, $41 per day on private pay, $10 per day on private insurance, which could vary up or down depending on the managed care contract, and $0 per day on Medicaid residents. The key to making a profit lies in your payer mix. We made 2 monthly projections for each month. One was based off of a 50% skilled mix, 50% long-term care mix, and the other based off of a 34% skilled mix and 66% long-term care mix. The difference in these projections was about $65,000 less net operating income for the projection with more long-term care residents. We projected a profit in 2017 of $286,000 from our on-site home hemodialysis program. If you recall, Aurora Manor's occupancy in 2017 was 75%. What I neglected to mention was the last quarter of 2016, occupancy dropped to 70% and did not increase until the end of December when the dialysis suite opened and we were able to start admitting residents to receive hemodialysis at Aurora Manor. As of May 2017, I am proud to say Aurora Manor is operating at just over 80% occupancy year-to-date and have been meeting our projected dialysis expectations. This increase is directly related to averaging 10 to 14 skilled and long-term care dialysis residents daily. Residents that receive on-site hemodialysis receive 4 to 5 treatments per week for 2 to 3 hours per day at Aurora Manor. Residents report feeling better when receiving dialysis treatments more frequently on-site rather than receiving 3 treatments per week off-site. Residents, families, and staff notice these patients to be less fatigued, less likely to miss therapy sessions, improved appetite, more active socially, and a reduction in medication. Some of the most positive reactions come from families. They are so thankful that their loved one no longer needs to be transported to and from dialysis. Many times this responsibility falls on the family to provide transportation. One family member was picking their father up at 5 a.m. 3 times a week to take him to dialysis. Once this resident admitted to Aurora Manor, we were able to treat him in-house, her stress level decreased significantly. She was so excited that her dad was healthy, safe, and didn't have anywhere to go to receive his dialysis treatments. She even decided to take a vacation to celebrate. Studies have shown that more frequent hemodialysis therapy lead to improved sleep quality and appetite, more energy, fewer medications, less stress on the heart, and a longer lifespan. The following is a success story of a resident that received on-site home hemodialysis at Aurora Manor. Resident A was initially admitted to Aurora Manor following a hospitalization for heart failure and chronic kidney disease. Resident A presented with elevated blood pressure, lower extremity edema, and a need for increased assistance with functional mobility and activity to daily living. Due to further complications with heart failure and chronic kidney disease, Resident A had 2 more hospitalizations and underwent a pacemaker implementation and started on hemodialysis. With a new pacemaker and initiation of dialysis, Resident A's functional status significantly changed. Upon evaluation with physical and occupational therapies, Resident A was only able to ambulate 20 feet with minimal assistance, transfer with minimal assistance, and complete bathing and dressing with moderate assistance. In addition to appointments and daily therapy, Resident A was transported to and from the dialysis site 3 times per week. This became very taxing, and Resident A stated, "I once had to sit and wait 5 hours for transportation to pick me up after receiving 5.5 hours of dialysis." With the opening of the new in-house dialysis at Aurora Manor, Resident A was able to receive treatments here. Resident A's attitude and participation improved. Therefore, quality of life improved greatly. Medically, blood pressure stabilized and the edema in lower extremities decreased. Functionally, all areas of functional mobility and activity of daily living improved. Upon discharge from therapy, Resident A was ambulating up to 200 feet with supervision, transferring with modified independence, and completing bathing, dressing, and toileting with supervision. At Aurora Manor, Resident A continues to receive hemodialysis and is still able to maintain functional status by completing the home exercise program in the therapy gym. Resident A and other patients who receive home hemodialysis at Aurora Manor can experience benefits such as better control of hypertension and anemia, increased energy, fewer dialysis-related complications, fewer medications, decreased fatigue, and hospitalizations related to dialysis. Resident A stated, "I am so thankful to have the most understanding and caring dialysis staff at Aurora Manor." Dialysis treatments at Aurora Manor were completed using NxStage System 1 dialysis machines. Advantages of using NxStage include the ability to perform treatments bedside or in a den setting. This flexibility was perfect for Aurora Manor since we began treatments bedside and eventually transitioned into the dialysis suite. The fact that the NxStage machines are small in stature and portable fit the needs of Aurora Manor and should be taken into account when looking at the size of resident rooms or a potential dialysis suite. Aurora Manor was able to comfortably treat 2 residents bedside in a semi-private room using NxStage System 1 dialysis machines. NxStage works with existing plumbing and electrical wiring and can be used in a smaller treatment space as shown in the picture above at Aurora Banner. It's the only true portable system cleared for home use and the most prescribed home hemodialysis machine in the U.S. Despite the health benefits that more frequent home hemodialysis may provide to those with chronic kidney disease, this form of therapy is not for everyone. Home hemodialysis with NxStage System 1 requires a patient and partner who are committed to being trained on and following the guidelines for proper system operation. If you have questions or would like more information, please visit www.nextstage.com/sniff. I would like to thank everyone for taking the time to hear about Aurora Manor's on-site home hemodialysis program. Please feel free to contact me if you have any further questions. My contact information is on the opening slide of the presentation. For more information about Saber Healthcare, please visit www.saberhealth.com. Thank you, and we'll now open up to any questions you may have.
Great, Corey, thank you so much. Just a reminder, if you'd like to submit a question for our audience Q&A, you can do that at any time. And if you'd like to download the slides from the presentation, those are available as well. And you can get those additional training slides in the appendix that Corey mentioned. And to view and print those, just click on Event Resources beneath the volume control and then click on the PDF of the slide deck. So to get started for our Q&A, we have a question from an administrator who asks if you dedicated the dialysis to only new admissions and how did you handle existing population who also needed dialysis. And they're also curious as to what percentage of new admissions use this service versus what percentage of existing residents use the service.
It wasn't just for new admissions. If we had somebody that was in our facility that was currently receiving dialysis treatments, they were more than welcome to receive treatments with us. It just depended on if they wanted to. That's the reason that, you know, people started coming on board so early. They heard that we were having it. One of the first people heard from a family member of one of our current residents that worked at a local church and came in so early. But it was also for any new residents that were at the hospital. And we did do long-term care residents as well, but if we have a potential for 18 residents to be treated, we want to try to maintain a 50% skilled mix, 50% long-term care mix, in order to be able to make a profit from the program. What was the other half of the question?
They wanted to know what percentage of new admissions versus the percentage of existing residents.
It was basically all new admissions. We had, when we started with the five, they didn't exactly come just to have our home hemodialysis program. They started with us, and we told them about the program and ended up staying on. So it really just determined on that particular, with that particular patient and their family and what they wanted to do.
Great. We have another question that's come in a couple times, wondering if Affiliated rents the space, and then who paid for the renovations?
No, the renovations were paid for by our company, and Affiliated does not rent the space. It is our facility, our space. Affiliated bills for treatments, but we our profit is from a head in the bed or our census. And you'd have to reach out to Affiliated Dialysis for more information on them specifically.
Great. We have one in from Thomas now that I believe you mentioned you have six chairs in the center, but he's wondering how much square feet you require per chair and what are the total square footage requirements for the full offering, the chairs, common area, sinks, nurse's station, et cetera.
If Thomas sends me an email, I'd be happy to get him specifics. As I mentioned before, the room was about 36 feet long by about 18 feet wide. At the end of the room, if you look in one of the pictures, you could see there's a closet at the end for where the TV is by the wall. On the other side of the room, I don't have a picture of that side, but there's an office space there, and the dirty sink is on that side as well. And then we utilize storage space throughout the in another room in the facility. So I can give him specifics on that. I don't have the square footage. The chairs have to be able, you got to remember, the chairs have to be able to retract completely to where it's basically a flat plane for the resident. So you do need, you know, I would say probably 8 feet, maybe a little bit less depending when the chair is completely extended. And from one to the other, I don't have the specifics on what's regulated, but affiliated dialysis told us what we needed, and we followed through with that.
Great. And like Corey said, his contact information is on the first slide, but if you'd like to email him directly, you can also do that at Corey, that's C-O-R-E-Y, dot B-E-N-N-I-C-I, at saberhealth.com. We have a question in now from Eric, wondering if having a unit made the skilled nursing facility more at risk for citations from surveyors.
It could absolutely. I mean, this was a new facility or a new program within Saber Healthcare. We tried to look at every step of the way and what could we potentially have problems with. But that's where you have to rely on who you're working with. And, you know, we have such a great clinical team with Saber Healthcare and thinking ahead of time of what do we need to do, how do we need to work with affiliated dialysis to make sure proper care plans are in place for all residents and that they're satisfied. You know, with it all being, like I said, a one-stop shop, you know, you're able to kind of dictate how things go with the resident and the family. So if there's problems, you know, I think we're very good at making sure we're following suit with those initial plan of care meetings to not only discuss, you know, their care, but also the dialysis initial meetings as well and how we work together. You know, one of the things with staffing this was we work with affiliated dialysis, but also we set one of our trained RNs as a supervisor. So that person, that supervisor, was really in constant contact with myself and my director of nursing to say how the training or how the treatments were going daily. So she would staff the program on a daily basis and determine what we needed and any issues or anything that would come up. Now, with this being new, you know, of course there's communication problems, and that's where we worked those out, you know, one by one and determined, you know, are we being notified of everything we need to? And that's when we went to basically, you know, meeting with her daily to say what's going on, if there's any immediate assistance, are we alerting affiliated dialysis so they can contact their medical director or the nephrologist, or us going above and beyond. I'm one where, for the regulatory perspective, you know, it can fall on us, so we can't rely on another provider to do something. We have to take the initiative and contact them to talk about what's going on to prevent any type of complaints from regulatory board.
Great. That was an awesome answer for that. We have a question wondering if you could explain what STNA stands for.
Sorry about that. That is a state-tested nursing assistant, or a CNA. I apologize.
Okay. No, thanks. Thanks for clearing that up. A couple questions coming in wondering who purchased the machines.
The dialysis machines?
Yes.
They are provided by affiliated dialysis. So, you know, for once again, getting back to the expenses of the project, the capital expenses was the renovations in the room, the chairs, the televisions, the plant specifically, and then the only expenses to the facility are the labor of our trained staff members that are providing the labor. Now, we could essentially, you know, have had affiliated dialysis provide the labor and paid them for that, and there wouldn't actually, I mean, it would still fall labor on us, but we wouldn't have to have any staff members or anything to do with it other than having it there at the facility and making revenue based off of the admission that came in. But that is all through affiliated dialysis, and they have the machines, and they bill for the treatments and receive reimbursement.
Great. We have a question now from Scotty, who's wondering if you had any special training for your admissions staff at Aurora for dialysis patients, or any special kind of things or red flags relating to admissions staff to keep in mind.
We did have trains. We that was specifically through affiliated dialysis. They trained us. We probably had multiple calls just to make sure everything went very smoothly. And once again, you know, this is doing some practice runs and things like that, and we tried those and did those. And, you know, the good thing about affiliated dialysis was that when we would send up the referral, because we all have to think about how quickly hospitals want information. Saber's policy on that is to get immediate answer back to the hospital if we can accept the patient or not. And we all know the hospitals want that. So that makes the importance of making sure we get in touch with affiliated dialysis to make sure they accept the patient as well. So that was really key to making sure things flow smoothly. And the training process went very well. And like I said, there were any hang-ups. It was just our admissions team understanding what needed to happen and getting all the information to affiliated dialysis so they can approve this to happen. The biggest hang-up, which started in the beginning, was just getting the hepatitis B results. And sometimes if the hospital didn't have those, we had to request it, then, you know, we'd have to reach out to the dialysis center. But after, you know, the initial startup, I mean, this went so smooth. Our admissions team got it. Affiliated got back to us very quickly, and we really didn't have any issues.
Wonderful. And a question about Rebecca, and you may have touched upon this, but to say what your staff to dialysis resident ratio is?
Sure. So, and once again, this can vary by state and provider. So, you know, depending on your state or who you're working with may differ, but in Ohio with affiliated dialysis, we had a 6-chair dialysis suite. So we had one RN in there to oversee treatments as the registered nurse, and then we had 2 to 3 trained dialysis technicians. Now, 2 could have done it at an acceptable level, but you also have to remember, as I've talked about, never sacrifice care. So we want to make sure this program ran smoothly, efficiently, and effectively. And in doing that, if our staff is spread thin and wasn't able to get to things appropriately, residents and families were going to lose trust in Aurora Manor. We did not want that to happen. We wanted the residents, we wanted their families, we wanted new referrals, we wanted the hospitals to trust us with what we were doing. So we would typically go the extra route and have an extra dialysis tech in there to make sure things were going smoothly, to go get that next person ready so that it can go. Once you start increasing your census and having more in there, you know, it's 2 to 3 hours, but you never really know exactly how long that person can go. It could be shorter, it could be longer, depending on the size of the patient and how long their treatment may be. So we had to make sure we were kind of flowing correctly so that all worked together. You know, if somebody needed to get down there, have an early breakfast, we could have that extra dialysis tech, you know, making sure they're ready to go, dressed and ready to come down to treatment, to get back there so they could have their meal afterwards, to coordinate with the dietary department on when they're coming back from their treatment so they could have their meal ready to go so nothing was waiting around as far as food goes. And, you know, so that was the reason to have that extra person and why I always go by the company motto to never sacrifice care.
Great. We have another question asking if you could repeat the financial results per resident payer category.
Sure. So after you subtract the general operating costs and the dialysis labor costs, a Medicare A, we could make about $160 to $200 depending on the RUG score. So if it's a high-paying RUG, like an RUB or an RUC, you know, that's what we kind of looked at. We actually went off of our budgeted Medicare A rate. So that's why the high end being 200, you know, is more likely. We were budgeted a little bit lower than what we were actually receiving. So a managed care or private insurance product, it really depended upon, you know, that contracted rate. If you have a low-paying contracted insurance, then, you know, we weren't going to make much at all with everything that was going on. But if you had a higher paying, in Ohio, we have the MyCare Ohio insurance, the MyCare products, which pay just like Medicare does, so we can make more on those. But we set it for $10, which isn't a lot, I know. Private pay was $41 per day is what we could make there, and Medicaid, you just break even. It was about $0 after all costs.
Wonderful. And we have one asking if LPNs can render services.
No, not in Ohio, or at least to my knowledge with affiliated dialysis. You'd have to follow up with them specifically, but the answer is no.
Okay, great. And we have one asking if you could talk a little bit more about residents' families' reaction and any input they gave to your on-site hemodialysis program.
I feel that it was very strong. I mean, everything is a case-by-case basis, but it depends on what was going on specifically with that person and with the family, and it all boils down to the coordination of care. You know, for a lot of families, as if they're a, you know, an older resident and the families are the ones providing transportation to the appointments, you know, this is huge for them. I mean, like, as I mentioned before, one of our first that came in, you know, they were rotating the schedule at 5 in the morning, and this was so taxing on the family. I mean, they hadn't been able to do family-type things for so long because they were responsible to take their father and to those appointments. So it really was all about gaining trust. And, you know, they wanted to know if we could coordinate the care appropriately with residents and families and make them feel comfortable with us and trust us. And that's where it all goes back to, you know, the staffing model as well, and why we had an extra person in the room, because we didn't want any type of complaints, regardless of what it could be, customer service, communication, care, therapy, meals, whatever you could think of. I mean, I remember myself personally, you know, going down to assure that when a resident was getting done with dialysis, that, you know, they had a hot meal ready for them, and you know, just coordinating those types of things. But I really believe that, and through everything that everyone that we've spoken to, the families are happy.
Wonderful.
I did want to touch on one other thing with the bedside and the staffing, how that works. When we were treating bedside, you have to have a dialysis technician in the room at all times. So that technician could be treating, if you had a semi-private room, they could be treating both residents, but they have to be in there at all times, and the nurse has to oversee and be within very close distance, the RN. So it's just a little bit different when you're doing bedside dialysis as opposed to the dialysis suite, because you have to have sometimes more staffing.
Sure. And kind of on that same note, someone wondering how many machines are required, and do you need to have one per resident?
No, everybody does not have their own machine. Or wait a minute, you'd have to refer to affiliated dialysis or NxStage for that question. I apologize, because I don't have the answer to that.
Great. And another is asking if there is a fee you need to pay to affiliated dialysis to provide the services on site.
No. There is not a fee. If they were to staff the project, then we would have. But with them not staffing, there is no fee. If there were a second round of training, would require the first initial round of training is in the contract, but a second round of training would require an additional cost. And that's why, you know, we have so many trained employees, so that way. You know, we trained 10 employees, so we ended up losing one person, took a government job, but other than that, nine people were trained, and they looked at it as an incentive, and, you know, they really felt that they were doing something of value for the facility and other residents. And that's where the screening process went, and we explained to them how important it was that they took this very seriously and knew that if they weren't going to be able to be there, then they were going to jeopardize the health of this resident.
Wonderful. And we've got time for just one more question, so we'll keep it on kind of the staff topic. Susie would like to know if some of your existing staff already had experience with dialysis, and if so, how did that drive the process?
No. The answer is no. You know, we received some really great resumes when we were looking into this for people that did have experience and would have loved to bring them on board, but we ultimately felt that you know, going with our internal staff members that have been working there and kind of grinding it out with us for years and, you know, that had a vested interest and cared about our residents was the best option for us. And none of them actually had any experience. And we weren't really looking for that because of the training process with Affiliated was so intense. And I don't say that in a bad way. I just mean that, you know, the trainer was terrific. The guy that did this, Steve, I mean, he had such a way to get things across to our staff members. They would spend, I believe it was a week of training, classroom training, and then 3 weeks with actual learning how to provide treatment. And what we did was, and I have some of this in the appendix, you know, going through. And I had to give a couple, my DON and I, we went in and had some motivational talks with our staff just because it was so important that they got this right and understood, hey, this is your time to train, this is your time to learn, and that they knew that how important the program was. So, but it went really well, and that's why the training process was so valuable and why they needed to be on their toes at all times with that. But they did not have prior experience.
Wonderful. Thank you, Corey, for that answer and for all of the insights you've shared with us today. If you did submit a question and it was not answered live, somebody will contact you with an answer for that. And if you have a question for Corey, you can also email him directly at corey.benici@saberhealth.com. We hope that you have enjoyed today's webcast. This session will be made available shortly at www.mcknights.com/May16webinar. We'd like to give our very special thanks to Corey Bennici for that great presentation today. We'd also like to thank our webinar sponsor, NxStage. You can check them out at www.nextstage.com. And finally, we'd like to thank you for attending today's session. You'll see that exit survey I mentioned earlier pop up on your screen as today's presentation ends, and we sincerely hope that you'll complete it. Again, we greatly appreciate your feedback on today's presentation. Once again, thank you so much for tuning in. This is Emily Mongan for McKnight's Long-Term Care News, hoping you have a wonderful rest of the day.